getting to know you, getting to know all about you, getting to like you, getting to hope you like me.
Hi, we're myself Darren.
Myself Miriam.
And myself Dinah.
Hello, Dinah.
Hi.
Nice, she knew to introduce herself.
Yeah.
She's a listener, tell
she
you
is
that
a listener.
Much.
Yeah.
Dinah, we've been in a bit of a rush to record this one. Why is that?
I am leaving in just over 2 weeks to move to London.
Aww.
Why?
For college.
Okay, but you're in college here in UCD.
Yeah, so there's this little thing called Erasmus.
Okay.
And you go away for, well, not everyone, but you can go away for a year to a different country. And I decided to be super exotic and go to London.
So you could have gone anywhere.
Yeah, I've
where are your
going
options?
To South Korea.
And whoa.
No, I wouldn't mean
China, Brazil. I have a few friends going to the US and Canada, that kind of thing, or anywhere, sort of mainland.
And you chose
Europe.
London.
Chose London.
Would a certain boy have anything to do with it? We won't mention any names, but a certain boy may have
had a bit of influence.
A bit of influence on the fact that you're not going too far and you can get cheap Ryanair flights back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
Very good, very good. And is it a nice college? Sorry, Miriam.
I was just going to ask what she's studying.
Oh,
what
yes.
What's she going over to study now?
What are you going over to study, Dinah?
Well, I study English and history here, but I'm just doing history next year.
Oh, because she's in England. She won't need the English.
Oh, she's here all day, folks.
And then, is it a good university? Yeah, I think it's a good university.
You think it is?
Yep.
Which university is it?
UCL, University College London.
Sounds good.
Mm-hmm. How good is it?
The 8th best university in the world.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, very good, very good.
Is it hard to get into, like, as an Erasmus student? Is that?
I'm not sure. I think you, like, basically how they do it is they take your results from Christmas and summer first year and Christmas of second year and average them, and then you basically write down your top 10 options where you want to go to, and they kind of do it like the CAO system. The people with the top the highest kind of average get their first choice, and then they'll go through the list that way.
Wow. Okay. You must have had a pretty high average, Dina.
Probably.
So humble, guys, so humble. Yeah,
what are we talking about today?
Well, oh yes, today on our podcast, as well as getting to know Dina, we're going to be talking about servanthood and what it looks like to be a servant from the biblical perspective.
Ooh.
So, yeah, let's get started. Okay, so Dina, you have served in our church. You taught at Lighthouse, which is our primary school age kids, on a Sunday morning. What else have you done actually here? Because you're only young.
Yeah, well, outside of this, I've helped out with BCM camps. I directed the equivalent age over the summer, and I also helped as a leader at the kind of young teens group as well. And then at the church, I've done a couple talks.
Very good. So you're well equipped to talk about our subject today, which mm-hmm. is servanthood. So our first question is, what is biblical servanthood, or what is servanthood? So we'll start with you, Miriam.
Oh, no.
Because I can see you just looking at Dina there.
Like,
as
yeah,
if
yeah, Dina knows the answer.
What Dina says.
What is servanthood?
Yeah, or like biblical servanthood, or what is servanthood?
I would just say, okay, servanthood, putting others before yourself. Biblical servanthood, putting others before yourself because of God.
Okay.
In very simple terms.
Okay, Dina?
I think kind of one of the main things you have to remember when looking at it, people have this kind of concept that serving is the same as servitude. And servitude is when you're forced into serving, so slaves and stuff like that. But when you hear being a when you hear someone saying that you're a servant, you automatically think that this is someone that's maybe been kidnapped and they're like forced into this, they don't get paid and stuff, and it's against their will at the end of the day.
Yeah.
But servanthood in a Christian setting is completely like humble, and humility is the core of it. And it's a love for helping others and a love for serving God and growing in your own faith as well as helping other people grow their faith.
Mm.
Very good. Very good. I like it. Yeah, because I was kind of looking into this a little bit, and for me, it's a dirty word, right? Because but it's not originally a dirty word. In the same way, here's a contentious one: wives submitting to your husbands.
Yes.
It's a dirty word. It's bad because we have broken it and damaged it. But servanthood is actually a positive word in God's kingdom because Jesus was a servant.
Mm.
So Jesus was God's servant, it says in Matthew. And so Jesus came to serve. So part of God's character is servanthood. But it's positive. It is sacrificing yourself to look after somebody else.
Yeah.
So that's what it is. And like, so for the negative, what humans have done, like what Dina said, was you were forced to sacrifice yourself for the better of others. So you were serving other people against your will. But in God's kingdom, it's a positive. It's actually part of God's kingdom is servanthood. It's a positive of what we do. It's not something that we feel that we I need to serve because I'm a Christian. But it's actually something we get to do as part of bringing in God's kingdom. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Which I found really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I never thought of Jesus, even though it says Jesus is a servant, but actually he was. Like, he never did anything that the Father didn't tell him to do. Because he said over and over again, I don't do anything by my own will. It's only what the Father tells me to do. That's what I do. And that's kind of what servanthood is. It's to do what's good for others over yourself.
Yes.
But it's only born of trust.
Yeah.
But we've broken it because, like, husbands abuse wives and like people have taken people into servanthood. So it's a broken trust, so it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. But it's actually a positive, I think. So then why should we serve? Dina?
Why should we?
Like, so why should we? So in like kind of a church setting in our church family, like, why should we serve? Like, what's the benefits of it?
Well, for the absolutely selfish reason of...
Because that's what serving is all about.
Yeah. Well, like, for your own, there's like, people have in their head, oh, I'm just helping others. It's like helping others. Well, we're told that like serving is nurturing our own faith with God and deepening our relationship with him. So even if nothing else, but for that reason, that's like what our main goal in life is to do, then why wouldn't we take a prime method of doing it? And the other reason would be Jesus served us. He gave everything for us. If we can try to repay him in any sort of way, wouldn't that be to emanate that? I know in, now I'm going to forget it, Matthew 25:34-40, I think it talks about
how... Now we know why she's going to the top 8 school.
Yeah, you can see why, can't you?
It talks about how Jesus is basically telling his followers, when you come to God, he's going to ask you if you helped me when you, did you help the sick? Did you visit the people in jail? Did you feed them and stuff? And by that, you're doing to me. And you might say to them, well, I never had the chance to help Jesus, but by helping any of my brothers and the people in the church, that's what you're doing. And that's what God will ask you on the day of redemption or whatever it is.
Very good. Yeah, because myself and Miriam were just kind of talking earlier on about something that is prevalent in our day, and so there's some positive in it, but we've taken it to the extreme of self-care and self-love, and that it's all about you when you need to look after yourself first. But actually, when we serve others, we are, it's like, it does serve us,
yeah,
because it does fulfill us. We are designed to be fulfilled looking after each other.
Yeah, even in a secular world thing, like, one of the things they say to do if you have high blood pressure or depression or anything is to serve people. You get so much self-gratitude and stuff out of it, and it really, really good health benefits. So yeah,
and pet a dog, I think, as well.
Had a dog, yeah. Well, you could dog sit. That could be how you serve.
Yeah. Dogs need love too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So so why do you think we should serve, Mir?
A lot of what Dina said. But
and now we need to stop letting her go first.
Yeah, don't we? Everything's crap in comparison. Why, like it said, we are to put others before ourselves. And I think it does definitely, I've found in my experience, it kind of holds you accountable. Like, you are expected to mm-hmm. prepare things and come prepared and have things done on certain times. But I think you definitely do benefit from that. Like, so I know, like, last week I was preparing to do communion and I was there on Saturday and I was like, oh my gosh, I have to sit down for like however long now and think about doing communion. Yeah. But I found at the end of the hour or whatever I'd spent, I had like got so much out of it and I was like, this is as much for me as it is for other people.
100%.
Yeah. But I also think just like the general functioning of a church requires servanthood for things to actually happen, like to make things happen. That is what is required. And you see that like a lot of churches really struggle with that because they don't have enough people volunteering or they just don't even have enough people there to run a service and run different things for different ages and groups. And that's a really difficult part. But I would say, to provide for your like church family members as well in order to feed them, let's say. Yeah.
And I think a certain amount that comes from that, it actually keeps you quite accountable. If like it'd be very easy to wake up on a Sunday morning and go, oh, I'm just not feeling it today.
Yeah.
Mm. But if you have something that you have to go and help today and like people are relying on you, like it keeps you involved in the church, because if you suddenly don't go 1 week, suddenly it's 6, 7, 8 weeks that you haven't actually been. Whereas if you have something really tying you to it and people relying on you, I think that kind of your part in the community is so much more and you value church more, I think.
Yeah.
100%. Definitely. Yeah. Because I remember, again, I'm going to quote him, Ross. He said before, the two ways to get young people to stay in church is to intergenerational relationships and to give them a job, to let them serve somehow, and that makes them feel a part of the community, and exactly what you're saying, helps keep you accountable because it forces you to go, oh, I need to make sure I'm here to do that, which is really important.
You've definitely taken Ross up on that.
I really have, haven't I?
Advice, Dinah, I can vouch for that.
Yeah, maybe we need to edit that out.
Yeah.
Ross is my hero, okay? I know, and it's the one thing, like, it just comes up time and time again because it's fantastic, because Ross is my hero. For me, I think, like, why should we serve? Because we are, for two reasons, we are bringing God's kingdom here, and servanthood is part of God's kingdom.
Mm.
And we're also going to be doing it in eternity. Yep. So like it's not like, oh, we need to do this and then when I get to heaven, it'll all be about me. It's like, no, God's kingdom, God's character, who he is servanthood.
Mm.
So part of ushering in his kingdom is just looking after other people above ourselves.
Yeah.
So it's that easy and that hard. It's like, how do I usher in God's kingdom? Look after other people above yourselves.
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of why it's important
mm-hmm.
for me. And we get to show people this is what God's kingdom looks like. And I think DEC does that well to a large extent. I mean, no church is perfect and we have our flaws, but they look after each other really well.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when my dad died, like my mother was just looked after so much and cared for, and people looked after her, like meals and praying and checking in on her. Even just that side of it that we don't see.
Definitely.
Of people just serving others. It's just wonderful. Really looking after each other.
I think there's just a good culture of it here.
Yeah.
Like it's a part of a lot of what DEC is and the people of DEC. Yeah.
Because I don't want to make sure this isn't a stick to beat people with in DEC, because you're like, oh, we need to get this done, we need to get that done, we need to find somebody to do this. But it takes, I think, 20 people to run a Sunday service.
Mm-hmm.
And if you actually look out at the people who are elders, directors, staff, who are on teams, who are teaching our kids, who are doing flowers and tea and coffee, huge, huge numbers of DEC, more than any church I've seen, serves.
Yeah.
So I think to some degree, servanthood is what we do well here, which is really good. So how did you start serving? I'll take this one.
Yeah, you start us off.
So how did you start serving? So I came back to church when I was 29 and my hero Ross. Okay, I feel like I'm not gonna be able to say his name anymore. So my hero Ross came up to me and was like, hey, so we did a thing on a Sunday morning called Kid Slot.
Which Kid was Slot.
Terrifying. So it was a fight, which Dinah didn't find terrifying. Dinah doesn't find anything terrifying, which is very annoying. So it was a 5 minute slot after the worship before the kids go out.
Oh yeah.
Where you bring the kids up to the front, yep. And it's just a way of interacting with the children before they go out. Mm-hmm. The thing is, you never know whether you're going to have 2 kids or 20 kids, whether yep. the kids are going to come up and interact or whether they're not going to come up and interact. So it was kind of, it's scarier than preaching for me, right?
Why? No,
because kids are such an unknown. And
was it interactive?
But that's the point. So I'm a very interactive person.
Yeah.
So if I'm creating something that's interactive and nobody interacts, you're just standing
that's
there like
awful,
a plant.
Yeah.
So it's always that. But like I kind of enjoyed it and it was good fun, but mm-hmm. it was terrifying. Anyway, he said to me, will you do Kid Slot? And I said, no.
Okay.
And he'd ask me again a while later, oh, will you do Youth Fellowship? And I'm like, no. And then I remember like I was praying one day and God said, stop saying no.
Wow.
Genuinely, it was one of those times where I know that he was like, stop yeah. saying no. So then Ross came up and asked me again, hey, will you do Kid Slot and will you do YF? And I said, yes. So how I started serving was by being badgered. but it was necessary. It was necessary because I think that we can do appeals from the front. We can send out emails and messages, but I think asking somebody personally to do
yeah.
something.
Yeah.
Most effective way.
It's the most effective Definitely. Way of getting people to serve because I don't know, we hate ourselves in Ireland. We're like, oh, I'd never be good at that. I'd never put myself forward.
If no one says to you personally, you think, oh, well, they don't really mean me. I'm not the
yes.
person for
yes.
it. Like, I could say it, then they might laugh at me thinking that I could do it.
Well, yeah. Or we get offended. Like, oh, well, they didn't ask me personally, so they're not. Like, it's just so random. We want, yeah. So personally being asked, I think, is good. But it doesn't mean that we shouldn't put ourselves forward.
Yeah. Mm.
So like on our webpage, we have do you want to serve? And you can serve in like all the different ministries. It doesn't mean that you're actually going to get to do it.
But you should
but
put
you're
yourself
putting your
forward.
Name forward and yeah. saying, hey, I want to serve. So for me, it was just being asked again and again, hey, will you serve? And I'm so happy because I wouldn't be here today if he hadn't.
Yeah.
And it was so scary because I was so shy. I really was like so shy. I used to make my sister come to church with me and she wasn't allowed to leave my side. And if she did, I'd just leave because I was terrified of talking to people. So God gently and then not so gently forced me out of that. So I served in Youth Fellowship for years and then ended up becoming an elder and yeah, God just very gently grew me.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I served.
Nice.
Dina?
Yeah.
Like How did you start serving?
How did I start serving? Well, mine slightly got a little bit of backstory to
okay.
it. That's okay. So I wasn't doing well sort of with stress levels and anxiety, and I think that was my phone.
It's okay.
Sorry, Cathy goes off every 2 minutes like she's doing the podcast.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I wasn't like sixth year. I hadn't done a full set of exams since my junior cert, and I just was really stressed going into school. Anything that had like crowds or anything, taking the train, I couldn't do anything. Like, I just really, really couldn't be around people. I'm gonna put this on silent. And yeah, it was like I just wasn't doing well. I probably went to school about 20% of the time, and I was just really, really stressed, and I just kept praying and praying. I was like, I can't do my leaving cert, how will I get through this? And like, and it was the first time I'd really turned to God properly for something going wrong in my life. Like, I'd never put that much like faith and control in him, and I was like, I have no other way out of it. I don't know what I'm gonna do. Like, every time I did my mocks and everything, they put me in my own room, but I just get seizures when I got stressed and I couldn't do it or anything, and it wasn't going well, so I didn't know what was gonna happen.
But you would never know to look at you.
No.
Yeah.
Like, you'd never know.
No.
Yeah.
That you go through stuff like that, because
yeah.
you just always seem so confident
calm
and calm and put together. Yeah, it's funny,
yeah.
isn't it?
Well, I think I'm a bit better now as well.
Yeah.
But
even at that time, like, because I had you in
yeah.
Encounter on a Sunday morning.
Yeah.
And like, you never would have.
No, yeah.
You hit it well, friend. Which is the opposite of what we're trying to
do
in the church.
I
finished it off by saying it wasn't a positive. I hope we're creating a culture where you actually can feel can, but...
Yeah. But anyway, COVID hit and I didn't have to do my leaving cert, which was the main thing. I'm not saying I called COVID, but God definitely helped me. But yeah, no. And that was a massive answer to prayer and probably like one of the most revealing moments of like the Holy Spirit sort of in my life and God's presence and everything. And then I sort of hit a point that I was like, well, I'll never be able to like thank God enough for that and never be able to repay him enough, apart from like the whole Jesus dying on the cross situation.
Yeah.
Like that was a thing to me that I was like, I'll never be able to repay it.
It was huge to you.
Yeah. And so I got involved then. I mean, everything was still in lockdown. I did a year of college in lockdown. There was no church or anything. But towards the end, when church was starting to reopen, I said to Ross that I'd help out sort of in any way he needed, and he had no one doing Lighthouse. After COVID, the entire Lighthouse team had dispersed. No one was running it. No one stayed around. There was nothing.
I came into a sinking ship, friend.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I just missed that.
The captain left and took the crew with him.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. No one came back. So
they'd all been doing it for like 10, 15 years. So they saw this as an opportunity to go, hey.
To go, okay. Yeah, I actually think that happened in a lot of churches. There was a lot of change.
Happened a lot everywhere.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, so Callie, because he was like, oh, we need someone to run it. I was like, well, I can't do that. But Callie, thankfully, took over it and she does really, really well. But I think I was her first volunteer then. And we eventually got a few parents kind of around us to help. And Al and Angel are there now as well, helping us. But yeah, still a pretty small team if anyone would like to help. Especially with me leaving.
Even though we're not asking you personally.
No, nothing personal, but like maybe if you're hearing this is God's the sign. But yeah, no. So that's how I got involved in the church originally, and then I realised I was good at it.
Yeah.
Nice. That's which it's we also good don't to have different, know. She wasn't asked.
No.
She asked, could she help?
Yeah.
Well.
You did.
But in our like college group, Ross did a few weeks on serving, I think, to kind of push people in. A little bit of manipulation,
So subtle, so subtle. Very good, very good. And it's good to actually acknowledge, like, God gives us gifts.
Yeah.
And gives us the ability to do things. That it's okay to say I'm good at it.
Yeah.
Like Dinah just said, and I found out I'm good at it. And I just wanted to hit her in the back of the head and go, who do you think you are? But it's true. Like,
yeah, it is.
It's okay to say,
yeah.
Like, I'm okay at it. Like, I'm good at it.
But it is true because a lot of people end up going into stuff because there's a lack in the church.
Yeah.
Like, okay, someone has to do this. And they do it. And it's not their thing. Everyone has a gift. Everyone has a section that they're good at. And a lot of time we fill up spaces because they have to be filled up, but they're not necessarily where our gifts lie. It's not that we can't do it, but it's not necessarily where like we thrive. But I think I find kind of the area that I did do well in.
Mm.
But yeah, that's why I more mentioned that I wasn't thrown into something because they had no one and I was like, it's not great. Yeah.
Like
but
me
I'm
in
still
administration.
Here.
Doing bookkeeping. That'd be hilarious. Don't ever put me in front of the books. stop the lights. What about yourself?
I think, you took Ross's advice and just, well, not badgered, but I arrived.
In, maybe?
No. But like I arrived in DC around February. I think I had in my head I'd kind of settle in a bit more before I kind of thought about serving. I'd suss it all out, you know, see what was like on offer, see where I thought I fit in. But you had other plans for me. So I think you just started asking me to. What was the first thing? Oh, I get my story was the first thing.
And then prayer. I got you to do prayer up the front, like intercessory prayer. No?
No, never.
I did that.
Communion?
Communion was later on. Anyway.
What else did you do?
I'm about to tell you.
You asked me as if you didn't know.
No.
Oh, okay. Anyway. Just a suspense.
Well, no, the first thing was, given my story. And then, we were just chatting. I was like, oh, I love the podcast you were doing it with Deepak. And you were like, oh, he's actually leaving. Do you want to take over? And I was like, yeah, I suppose I can talk, you know.
Just about.
One of my gifts.
You've been given the English language.
Yeah. And you got me to do one simple thing a couple of times.
Yeah.
So like our young adults after church thing.
Where we just got to talk about the service and try and take one thing away from it.
Yeah, so you got me to lead some of those discussions, and then most recently, service leading on communion.
Oh yeah, because we've created a new role, which is the service lead.
Yeah.
So kind of basically going back old school where we had a chairperson, like somebody chaired the meeting. No, it is.
I love it.
It's interesting.
Can I call myself chairperson? Awesome.
Yeah, the chairperson.
Thank you.
The chairwoman. Chairperson. So it's just interesting that things go around in circles, but you put a new spin on it, which is what we're doing. And also I have more things up my sleeve that you're going to be doing as well. But you just have one of those, you're just an all-rounder.
So I have a question slightly about, you said you're going to add stuff on.
Yeah.
What about over giving people way too much stuff?
Great question.
That's a really good question. Especially in servanthood, because what tends to happen is
certain people
find,
do too much.
You find there's a couple of people who are just all rounders who you can just rely on to do just quite a broad range of things. Mm. So I know in the past you burn people out.
Mm. Yeah.
And I've talked to people in the past who've said to me, the only time anybody ever called me was when they wanted me to do something.
Yeah.
They never called me to just say, hey, how are you doing?
Yeah.
And so that always stuck with me. So when I came here, I really want to invest in people.
Mm.
So if you're going to do something, so there are like, you can do like little jobs like praying on a Sunday every now and again, or like service lead, which like it's once every 6 weeks and it's not a huge, but your main, like, so I have people in youth fellowship. That's their main. So I won't allow them to do anything big after that.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're looked for from their team, I'll say no. Because some people will just say yes to everything.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because we feel again,
pressure
to. Well, not even pressure, but like, maybe God wants me to do this if they've asked me.
Yeah. Mm.
Because we don't really know how to say no sometimes. Yeah. It's funny, some people just don't know how to say yes. But like, no, they don't.
But
some people don't know how to say no, because you're like, maybe this is God calling me to do this.
Yeah.
So we need to, as a leadership, make sure that we're protecting those who are actually serving and making sure that they're not. So, for example, Dinah has wanted to do 50 things in the past.
Mm.
And we're like, no, Dinah, this is what you do and you're not taking on too much. So we have to protect our people and invest in them personally.
And I would say, protect and, I suppose, check in on where they are spiritually, that they are in the right position to be leading. Because you can start off in a really good position to be leading and 6 months down the line, you're not there anymore.
100%,
That's something that's really important. That's a constant thing, not just when they're starting the job or, you know.
Yeah.
But what we're trying to do here, actually, and it's for the staff as well, I think that's important. And kind of like all ministry leads should have... We were talking about mentors on the podcast for last week. Should have a mentor outside of kind of DEC so that you're accountable to somebody.
Mm.
So that, like, I don't know where the other staff members are spiritually. So they could be absolutely nowhere and doing really badly. Whereas a staff setting may not be the best because you work together.
Yeah.
So kind of making sure. So all of our service leads, I would like us to get to a point where anybody who's in a ministry lead has a mentor as part of the role.
That's really good.
Need to have somebody who you go and meet regularly to pray with and talk to and make sure you're okay.
Yeah.
Which again is investing in our people and making sure they're not overworked, which is important. Does it matter if we don't serve?
Well,
to put a negative on the positive, like, does it actually matter if we're like, if we just come and don't serve?
Well, I suppose, like, kind of taking it back to the verse I was talking about earlier, Matthew 25:34-40, if we're going to be asked come judgment day, how did we help Jesus in this thing? Like, can we give that case of how we helped raise, like, money to help people, or giving to the poor, or praying for people? And not praying for people as in, like you said, a prayer tonight, but like, if you're on like a prayer team or you helped like serve, there's so many different ways to serve, but like, can you say that you did that if God asks you?
Okay. Okay, that's very harsh. I like it.
No, I don't think it is.
Okay. That's okay. No.
I think that's what scripture says.
Yeah.
No, Miriam, I'm saying it's accurate. You can stop jumping down my throat, Miriam.
Sorry.
I don't have a baby today. Potentially.
Well. Right, let's not bring that into it.
Listen, if it comes today, it'll be a miracle.
I know. And my phone's on silent, Dina, even though I have a baby, Jill. Don't tell my wife I said that. It's on.
Can we give a shout out to Marilyn?
Yeah, shout out to Marilyn because she's due the baby. And the baby may come at any moment. It probably won't.
I feel like you'll have enough time to get that.
Oh, I will, 100%, yeah.
It won't come at any moment.
Darren's beat, so it's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do.
I wish people could have seen the look I got there.
That was a private conversation, Miriam.
Is it?
What happens in confession stays in confession. No, it doesn't actually. I do speed. But we're getting way off topic. What was the question?
It doesn't matter if you don't serve.
Oh, it doesn't matter if you don't serve. Mm. Yeah, I think it does because the church doesn't work without it.
Yep.
So if we don't have people who serve, like... The only reason I'm here today is because people taught me when I was in junior church, people invested in me and prayed for me. There are specific people who prayed for me. There are people in this church who've been my mentor. There are people who have actually invested in me.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're not going to invest in the younger people or other people around us and serve each other, then the church just doesn't function. It's created to only function through servanthood.
Yeah.
So even just a base functionality point of view, it just doesn't work.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people, we were talking about that earlier, it's kind of like just our mindset of consumerism.
Oh no, you can't steal my point. That was my point. But go on anyway, I'll let you have it.
Sure. you can add something on, I'm sure. I'll miss something. Just so many people come to consume, and I was in that mindset, like coming and I was like, oh yeah, I'll come and like see what I get from it for a bit and then I'll give. When I kind of find out where to give and whatever. But you get from giving. So like, get stuck in as soon as you can. And yeah, it doesn't work if everyone just comes to consume. It's that whole thing of full circle. You have to be giving in order.
Because what did you say at one of your youth groups before?
What? Oh, yeah, sorry. I was a fairly judgmental person back in the day.
You were not.
Really?
Yeah, but no, not sorry. This... Yeah, not even judgmental. I think I was just getting frustrated once. I was going to a group and I was like, I just don't feel like I'm getting anything from it. And I was like, what is the point of me even going to this anymore? And someone called me out there and then and just was like, well, maybe you're not there to get anything. And I was like, what? And he was like, maybe God has placed you there to give. And then I was like, oh yeah, I've been so focused on what I'm getting out of things that like I forgot that I was called to serve and to give, and in that you do get anyways, you know, like I was saying when I had to prepare for communion, I was like, oh gosh, and then I got so much out of preparing for that. So
I thought your phone was on silent.
Is that the point you wanted me to make? Yeah
that was really good. It was on silent, but I told you my wife could pop any moment. I'm like, oh,
I thought when I was talking to Sam about when him and Holly were picking a new church to move to and they're considering coming to DC, and one of the things they thought about was like identifying from the beginning how could they serve and help this church, because it's really easy to go into a machine where it kind of looks like everything's working and just kind of sit back and like, as you said, be a consumer. But I really thought like, I was like, wow, like that's really good to have that thing in your mind that you're going to go in and you're going to like help. And like they've done so much for the church. Like it's brilliant.
Yeah,
it really is. And I really don't think that we pay enough attention to the consumeristic attitude that we have because we are so me-centered now.
Yeah.
Because we're busy people, right? Because we are. Like we've never been so busy. But we don't... Busy doing what? Like hamsters on a wheel, right?
Yeah. Literally.
Genuinely. No, like we are, we're busy doing nothing. Like you really are. Like you go to bed going tired, but we don't always seem to achieve too much. No. So we're always really busy. And then we're all about me.
Mm.
So like I need to look after me and I need to, and so there you do, but Jesus says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And so when we do for him, it actually fulfills us and mm-hmm. we feel like we are achieving.
Yeah.
So I think the selfish point of the day, what people will take home from this is give to receive, friends.
Yeah. Yep.
Because like when we serve, like it fulfills us and it gives us so much joy. And no, like everybody is gifted. Mm-hmm. And every part of the body is necessary. Mm-hmm. Every part is yep. necessary. And while some are more obvious and visual
yeah.
or visible, every single part of the body is necessary. And I think one of the big negatives that I've seen, especially amongst young people, is, oh, I could never do that.
Mm.
Or
mm.
I would, no, clearly not any of people in this room. Because you are, like, you know that you are good at, and you're gifted and you do it, which is great. But there are people who are like, oh, I can never do that. I'm not able to do that. And we're actually criticizing God and saying, no, God is not able to use me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's an arrogant pride thing.
Yeah.
Like, oh, God could never use me. As if he's too small to use somebody like me.
Mm.
So I think we've talked about that before with Moses making God angry, remember?
No.
At the burning bush where Moses is like, oh, send somebody else, I can't do it. And his anger burned against Moses.
On the podcast.
Maybe, I thought it was with Kathy's podcast, but maybe not. I don't know what, after my Ross thing, I feel like I'm repeating myself quite a lot.
I have no recollection, but okay, very positive. Okay.
Yeah, like Moses, like God got angry, his anger burned against Moses because Moses said, no, send somebody else, I can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like that's, go on.
But I think it's also like when you say serve to someone, they're like, okay, I either have to work with kids or I have to stand at the front of the stage and like, I can't do anything.
Yeah.
I think people have like a very narrow-minded idea of what serving actually is. And like, even like the welcome team, they're like, oh, I can't talk to new people or anything like that. And it's like just tea and coffee, like putting biscuits on a plate or, and that's like big, like that helping everyone, anything. Yeah. Helping clean or like organize the kitchen. Hillary's great. She wouldn't run without her. People that help with the gardens. Like I'm here quite a lot during the week. And if you come here any day in the morning, the church is full. Like there's always people buzzing around, whether they're running a small group, they're helping just maintain the church, whether they're just volunteering to help do the accounts, the bookkeeping that Darren definitely can't do.
definitely not.
Even just like the directors, the financial directors, everything. Like it's not, and there's a prayer team as well. People that just sit in the background, they pray for people.
Yeah.
Everyone's serving. You don't have to be.
And we have a page on our website.
Ship person. Yeah.
We have a page on our website that details all of the areas that you could serve.
Mm.
But it's coming with an attitude, again, of not what can I get, but what can I give?
Yeah. Mm.
So coming with an attitude of, I may, like, it could be like the poor widow who has like, the widow's mite, like the 2 cents that you're giving to the church. You may not feel like you have much.
Yeah.
But to come with an attitude of going, God, I don't think I have much, but I want to give you.
Yeah.
So to just come and talk to somebody.
It also builds up your skills though when you do get involved. You might come and know pretty much nothing, but there's people in all those teams that will help you and will grow your skills, and you'll go out of it actually. As we were saying at the beginning, Darren could end up writing that he's now a producer on his CV. You know, if he didn't serve in this aspect, he wouldn't have that experience.
Oh, yeah. Like, and I was like so shy and so reserved that like doing actually really benefited me. Like, I mean, God created us to do and to serve each other. Mm. And that's how we grow. And then we grow in friendships with each other. Mm. It's so good to serve.
100%.
Like it really is. Mm. But it just takes time and effort.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it
costs you to serve.
Yeah, a lot of it, like you were saying, is like mindset. I know I didn't serve in my home church and I really regret it now looking back, but it was because I couldn't see anywhere I could serve. I was like, well, I don't play an instrument, so I can't be on worship team. And I'm not good with little kids, so I can't do Sunday school. And it was kind of, you were almost looking for excuses. And then I know when I came here, one of the first things I was trying to do was identify where I could serve. And I was looking at welcome team and different things where I did have skills. And sure, I never thought I'd be on a podcast, but here I am.
Oh, it's gas.
Yeah, but I was having a conversation with someone recently because we're both students, both Christians. And I said, do you tithe 10%? So we were talking about this and she said, no. She said, I don't, but she said, I definitely give more than 10% of my time to the church. She said 100%. She said, I give more than 10% of myself to the church and to God. And she was like, I think that's all that can be expected of me right now. It, so I think like looking at things that way, you know.
Controversial.
Yeah, yeah.
No. Well, like that's.
Well, she was like, I'm a student. I can't afford to do that. But she was like, but I give so much of myself and my time and my energy. She said, I spend more of my energy in church than I do my college work and whatever. And like, that's a great way to look 100%. At it as well.
Yeah, I thought that's really good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go. Something to think about. Food for thought.
So I'll never have to tithe ever again. Although I'm not a volunteer, so I probably do. So let's go, because you were talking about BCM earlier. So this is kind of our last question is, so we can see serving in ministry is important. So coming to church and kind of serving. But what does it look like outside of church? So like you're talking about BCM, but in our everyday life, because we can kind of see servanthood and serving as a ministry that we do in inverted commas. So like I come and I do a podcast, or I come and I lead at church. But like servanthood is a way of life that we have. So like what does it look like for you guys outside of church in your just day-to-day life?
You can start.
It's so difficult.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I find it can be so difficult and can also make me so proud.
Okay. Very good.
I've got those two where I beat myself with a stick because I take time to watch something on Netflix for an hour when everybody's in bed when I should be doing, I don't know, something. And then at other times I'm like, oh, am I great for this? Like, I wonder what people would think if they knew. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so it's kind of, so I like serving.
Mm-hmm.
Like
mm-hmm.
I do. I like looking after people. I like caring for people.
Mm.
But I'm also very selfish.
Sure, aren't we all?
I know. That's what I like. So, boy, we can kind of cancel out our selfishness by the fact that we go, well, I do this and I do that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But that servanthood is actually a way of life. Like, if you look at Jesus, every part of his life was servanthood.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every aspect of his life was serving his Father.
Yeah.
And so, it doesn't mean... So, I also want to deal with another point as well, because I forgot until right now. So, for me, it's... remembering to be serving. So when I'm driving, and there's somebody
speeding,
driving.
You mean?
No, just normal driving. And I'm in the outside lane, and there's somebody in front of me that's going too slow for the outside lane.
Yeah.
Then I need to be serving. So how am I serving that person by not driving too close to them and flashing them?
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? Like, so, like, I know that might sound very abstract, but like, how am I serving God? Through how I do my everyday life. So how am I his servant? How am I sacrificing myself for him and being his servant every day in all my interactions?
Yeah.
And I think we can be very self-involved and consumeristic outside of church where like it's my time and like, or when we go into a shop and we're in a queue and it's like, oh, I need to be somewhere. And it's like, well, hold on a minute. How can I serve God and die to self in a queue in Tesco? Do you know what I mean? Like.
Okay. Gosh, so, I don't think I've ever thought that.
Yeah.
Have you not?
No. Not while I'm queuing. How can I serve God?
Well, because the attitude is like, oh, for flip's sake, I need to get somewhere. And because then you see people as an obstacle rather than people to love, because the cashier is so slow and she keeps on talking to people.
Right.
And you're like, for goodness sake, like, you're here to do your job.
Yeah.
So then they just become a thing that's either in your way or that's good.
Or that's helping you.
Or helping you. Yeah. And then we really like people.
That's true.
Who, because they do us good. So then it's still about us rather than having a servant heart saying, like, how can I serve God by loving people? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Even in the queue in Tesco.
Yeah, I suppose when you put it like that, it made me think, okay, well, if the kind of ultimate server is Jesus, servant is Jesus, and we're meant to kind of emanate our lives slightly to kind of reflect him, how would he go into that queue in Tesco? Probably not. Like, he'd be patient and kind and that sort of thing. And when you started talking there, I was like, do you mean that we're kind of like, we're trying to like evangelize everyone?
No,
or
not at all.
It's just kind of, what serving means for God. It's like showing, reflecting everything, sort of what Jesus stands for, love and humility and patience and all that kind of thing. So yeah, how does that come into my everyday life?
Does it come into your everyday life? So this is like a vulnerable podcast.
Yeah.
Where we're absolutely honest. And sometimes when we're doing the podcast, we're like,
feel pressure to.
Well, you can feel pressure, but also when we were talking about the mentors, we're like, actually, this is something I really need to do.
Oh,
now.
Yeah.
If you're like, hey, I'm so selfish, I don't do anything for anybody, that's totally fine.
Well, no, see, I wouldn't say that.
Okay.
I wouldn't say
I'm not that bad.
Yeah, I'm not that bad. No.
So what I was thinking
I'm
was,
kind of middle of the road.
I wouldn't go into it going, oh no, I'm the complete opposite of that.
Mm.
I would have thought I would be more willing to do stuff and would be more out of like, I don't really like conflict, you know? Like, I wouldn't get annoyed at people. Like, I wouldn't like get frustrated in a queue or anything. I'm just sort of, you know, whatever way it is. And kind of get on with my day. But it's not that I do it out of a heart of being like, oh, I'm emanating Jesus in my life, you know? Yeah, so yeah. I'd say I'd
naturally. So still selfish.
Probably, but not consciously.
Yeah. Of course.
Yeah.
What about yourself, Mir?
I think mine is very relational based. So say we were talking about that there with the queue. I don't think I've ever had that thought process in a queue because I'm like, these are all strangers. Doesn't make a difference. But I do find going into college or going into work, I would like on my way pray and I'd be like, God, like just make this day what you want it to be. Use me in the workplace and like my relationships with my coworkers and like let, you know, conversations come up or whatever where I can serve you and that I can like, I think I spoke about this before. I was just saying like the workplace is just the most negative. It's just where everyone goes to complain and they're like, when am I leaving? They're just like, get me out of here. Because everything for them is just like work is just, what's the word? Like just lets them do everything they actually want to do outside of work, which it is for a lot of people. And that's fair enough, but it's just the negativity. So I think trying to like, serve and like be that the positivity and have a reason to be joyful in the middle of all the miserable people, that is maybe how I would go about serving. Or like, yeah, but I don't think I ever think about it with strangers or just people I would cross paths with once. It's people that are in my life that I have a relationship with. I try to serve them in my everyday,
which is like hugely important because they're the ones you impact the most. But also I feel, because what came to my mind there was in John 9 where Jesus was going past the blind person.
Yeah.
And so much of Jesus' ministry was just randomers that
that's
came across.
That's true, absolutely.
Because he's aware.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And so, you're standing in the line of Tesco, you're probably not going to hear somebody's deepest, darkest secrets and like pray for them. But even just being aware and saying hello to somebody, like being aware of people other than yourself.
Mm.
Regularly as part of life opens up opportunities to share Jesus' love with people, whether it's evangelizing or whether it's just caring for people.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? Like, so asking the cashier, how's their day going? Like, how are you doing?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But nobody asks them that. They're just an entity there to get me through this.
Al is so good at that. Everyone he meets, he's like, I'm not a small talk person
like you.
And like, to me, it's just like, I'm getting through this, like, I don't know. Even, like, if I meet new people, if you come across me, I either feel, like, really, like, rude or just, like, really shy. Most people take shy from what I understand, but I'm sure a few people have thought, oh, she's really cold, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, I'm just really, really difficult to warm. Like, it's not that I'm, like, oh, I can't talk. I don't know what to say. I don't know what they'll think. I don't know anything. And so to me, strangers like get in, get out, don't wanna like talk too long or anything. We'll go to the people like you're in TK Maxx and be like, so is it busy today? And how's it getting?
Everyone
he comes across. And like, because I'm like an observer, I take everything in.
Yeah.
And you can just like, at first, a lot of them are just confused that they're being asked. They're like, sorry, what? Like, not like they're in their own world. But most of them at the end of it are like happy. And they just seem a little bit uplifted and they're able to get something out and stuff, which is quite interesting. So it definitely makes a difference.
Yeah. It does, definitely does.
There's one thing, and I try to do this as much as I can, and I do think it makes a huge difference. Father Peter McVeary once was on the Tommy Tiernan show, and he was talking about, I think Tommy Tiernan asked him about giving money on the streets to homeless people, or people begging, and he just said, look, a lot of the time you can't, a lot of people don't have cash on them, but he said, just acknowledge them.
Yeah.
And honestly, I live in inner city Dublin, and you walk past so many, and every time you walk past, sorry, love, do you have any change? And just actually going, sorry, I don't carry any cash on me. You can tell they're genuinely like, oh, that's no problem at all. Thanks so much. You've acknowledged that they exist and that they spoke to you. And that means so much to them. Like, they're not considered human, but to a lot of people, it's just a...
And I think...
Ignore them.
Honestly, when we give people money, it's for ourselves, not for them.
100%.
Because it's always to make ourselves feel better because we feel awkward and bad that there's somebody in that situation.
Yeah.
And so we give them money to appease our own guilt because we feel bad just walking past them. But again, acknowledging somebody as a human being and taking a couple of minutes or a minute or two to talk to them costs you.
Yeah.
It costs you small talk. It costs awkwardness. And no, it does.
Yeah.
But we're servants.
Yeah.
And that's what we do. So just the last one is being a doormat. The difference between being a servant and being a doormat. Because...
No, keep going.
No?
I don't know. I'm like, I don't even know what to say about that.
Goes back to what we were saying about saying no at the beginning, near the beginning, probably the middle, I'm not really sure. Knowing your limit and being able to go, well, that's too much, like for you, Miriam. If Darren's like, okay, well, you're doing the welcome thing and you're going to be doing the opening, the chairperson, and you're doing the podcast, and him to suddenly go, and I think I'm going to add you to the tea and coffee and stuff, and then suddenly you're here for the welcome, you're doing that, and we're going to increase when you're doing that, and for you to go, actually I can't, or I don't think I can, and for also for Darren to realize that Miriam can't take on more. And so to not become a doormat, you need to be sort of self-aware on your own limits, and it takes the church's leaders and the team leaders to go, okay, how else can I utilize? Because a lot of churches have some great people, like really, really great people in them that don't know how to delegate and take it, just keep it all on and do it all themselves, or give it to like certain people that they trust because they're micromanagers and stuff. And it's about going, well, no, this person might not do it the way I'd personally do it, but that's not necessarily wrong. And being able to kind of dish it all out.
Yeah. And I was kind of more thinking about in life outside. Because if we're serving people outside and we're kind of servants, there's definitely people who'll take advantage of your kind heart.
Oh, 100%.
And so we kind of feel that we can't say no to people, because then we're not showing God's love and we're not being servants. And that it's actually okay to have good, healthy boundaries and say no.
Yeah, and I also think...
That's okay. That's part of like being a good servant, is knowing when to say no, and that it's okay to say no. Sorry, Miriam.
And I also think praying for wisdom and things like that, and then actually being able to tell when people are taking advantage of you, because it's the same people over and over, but you kind of will get a sense of that, of who's genuinely in need. If they text you and say, hey, can you help me with this, can we meet up, and then there are people that it's just, I don't know, they're just using you, they're just consuming.
You're convenient.
You're convenient and it works for them.
It's okay for you to just back away from that and set up healthy boundaries for yourself to protect yourself. And I'm not sure people always know that. That it's okay for you to kind of go, actually, you're just really using me right now and you're taking advantage of my kindness, and that's not a good place for me to be in. And that it's okay to back away from that. Does that make sense?
That's really good.
As long as you're kind of saying no kindly, you know.
Of course.
Because you're not messing people around. You're not going, maybe, and then suddenly going, oh, I can't make it, and like lying.
Actually
telling them why. I think it's really important. So they're aware, and it's not just you kind of disappear out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Okay, well, getting the eyeballs here because this is too long. Even though I don't care if you like to listen to it or not. I've thoroughly enjoyed today. Dinah, thank you so much for coming on. And we will be praying for you as a church community and as a college group while you're away.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Thanks, Dinah.
Bye. Beautiful and new.